Let me make sure my readers are on right. Welcome, okay. Everyone. Welcome, everyone, to the Wednesday Night Live show. I am your host, John Troncalli, and the hostess with the mostest, Mr. Tim Swift, is there with us. And maybe Phillip's having some power issues in the great state of Alabama.
Mm-hmm. And Allison's on a journey yeah. for an interview. Yeah, she's 2 hours away from home, so we're wishing her all the best and hope that she makes. I figured tonight, John, I'm going to dial it back. I'm going to take it back about probably 30, 35 years, and I'm going to have my mouth right up on the microphone. I wish I could bring in a really close shot, like just right here in my face area. And all of you older people on the show that watch.
Hold on. I can arrange that. Hey, Hold on. Go ahead.
Get it right in just on my lips. Just get it right in on my lips.
I can't. It's like,
okay, that's you're okay. in the right. All right, I don't want to spoil the fun, but I'm going to take it back about, I don't know, it's probably 40 years now, but I was going to do my radio DJ shot, or like I'm going to do the show in the form of the lady from the Warriors movie, where all you saw was her lips. I'm going to be like, hey, all you vape boppers out there.
Hold on.
We're going to try the music. Those vape warriors are trying to make their way back to Coney Island. So keep your eyes peeled. That baseball gang named the WHO is coming for you. So all you boppers out there, stay safe.
I forgot the bopper term. I remember the bopper term.
Hey, all you boppers out there. Anyway.
Would you have been Venus the flytrap, or would you have been Dr. Johnny Fever on WK?
No, probably Dr. Johnny Fever. but everybody remembers. I think if anybody knows, I think the lady that played the role in the movie The Warriors, and she was the DJ. I know somebody watching the show has seen that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I think she was the same actress who later on, probably in the 2000s, was like on the show Dora the Explorer, like when they had like the kids show or whatever. She was like the actress on there. I don't know. It's funny how you see people and you're like, I know those lips. I know I've seen that lady before.
The Warriors. I remember that.
Yeah. The movie The Warriors. Yeah. With John Beck in it. And they went to the big gang meeting in New York City, and Cyrus, the leader of the Riffs, got shot. The guy standing up on the pedestal going, can you dig it?
Don't ruin it. Somebody in the chat might have not have seen the movie. You know, we do have such a younger crowd.
All right. So for all you cult movie freaks out there who like to watch stuff like not Buffy and the Vampire Slayer, not Red Team, Blue Team this, Team that, go pull up Netflix or Amazon Prime and pull up the movie The Warriors. There you go. Lynn Thigpen right there. That's her. Yeah. Warriors, come out to play. You got to go watch the movie The Warriors. It's an all-time classic movie.
Yes.
It's so good. It's way better than A Clockwork Orange. It's a cult classic. Go watch it today. Sorry. Back to the show.
Our topics tonight, New York City sues 11 more vape distributors, article by Jim McDonald. Link is also in the header of the page. And House Oversight Committee will question FDA commissioner. Also another article from Jim McDonald, and link is in there. And then we're just going to have kind of like open topics. And I do have a feel good story, and the feel good story is funny only because it's something that Nick Orlando posted today about Florida police officers. And then it was just happens to be that my story is about Florida police officers, but it's a better story than what he had. So if you're out there, Nick, this had nothing to do with your story. I already had this picked out because I knew Allison wasn't going to be here today. And I seen this article. And then when I read your post today, I was like, oh shit, this kind of contradicts with what Nick had to say about Florida PD, man.
All right, I need to disclaim one thing, Phil. I'm not trying to downplay Clockwork Orange. Absolutely, cult classic. I mean, you can put a Clockwork Orange right up there with Rocky Horror Picture Show. Like right in the time frame that I was going to high school, everybody loved both of those movies. I think we sat in people's basements drinking Bartles and James coolers, watching a Clockwork Orange. Just for me, The Warriors just was a very unique movie at the time. And I remember it well because I was a young kid, really young.
Yeah, it shot well, too. The story is really well done on that movie. So I think that the cinematic feel of that movie is, I think, is a little better than Relax, Phil, than Clockwork's Orange.
Yeah, no, well, I guess the point I was trying to make is that, you know, it resonated with me because I wanted to see it so bad because I was too young to see it when it first came out. So all my older cousins were like, oh, we went and watched Clockwork Orange, and they told all the little tidbits and stuff, and you were like, I want to see it. And I couldn't see it. Anyway, all right. But I like Clockwork Orange, too. I do. Yeah.
Both movies are great movies.
Yes.
Both of them. What else are we? Yeah, I have a feel good story, and the feel good story. Let me open it up. This is a pretty interesting little. It's funny. It's funny that it worked out with Phil's, but it says Florida police officer completes grocery delivery after arresting delivery drivers. So we'll get into that. That's fucking funny. You arrest them, and then they look back there and go, oh, look, he's got groceries back there. Let's complete the fucking delivery.
You have to maybe wonder where the cops stole the groceries from. Well, he didn't.
Hey, I guess it's a good thing. I mean, the cops could have said, hey, screw it. It looks like I don't have to go grocery shopping this week, so just take whatever's back there.
Exactly.
We'll dig into that, but everybody knows what time it is at this time.
I'm going to tell everybody how my week's been.
Yeah. Go do that, Timmy. Yeah.
Since there's only two of us, it's going to go real quick. So don't worry. We're not going to bore all you people with our long-winded stories. Actually, my week has been rather uneventful. Just work. And we're getting a new magnetic door with key fobs installed down at the pool. So we're upgrading at the pool. So for this week in your HOA news, we're upgrading at the pool and we're getting a FOB fob key gate thing. So I get to crank my nerd back up again and get involved with all that stuff. So it's been interesting. It's been a 2-day process so far. We have one more day to go, and then the neighborhood can rejoice.
I can't wait to hear the story where you eventually put your foot down and just, you know, that word, I'm trying to come up with that word with authority, you know, just you come in with, you know, like, fuck, it's Tim's way or the highway, bitches.
Oh, you want the classic old Western saloon type thing where I come busting in through the saloon doors, just foot in perfect, and the doors just swing open, and I'm like, there's a new sheriff in town. Yeah. And this town's only big enough for the two of us.
That's right. That's what I want to see. You can't go swimming in the pool with jean shorts on. God damn it. That's it. I'm putting my foot down.
You got to shower before you get in the pool. Them's the rules.
I'm waiting for that story. I think we're going to get it this summer. I think it's going to happen this summer. Tim's just going to just be taken to his limit. And he's going to have to just pull out I am the president of the HOA club.
Would it not be like a classic moment? Just like, what was it? Just like Addy said, what do you say? Gunny's here, punks. Wouldn't that be awesome if then I could then adopt like a Clint Eastwood thing with the little kid that was like squirt gunning all my signs and stuff? I could just like with the saloon door thing, just kick him like, and then just be like, go ahead, punk. Yeah. Make my day.
Well, before you kick the door in, you got to blow a big cloud. You got to blow a big cloud.
Yeah, I got to come in like, you know, with a big mango cloud just envelops the pool.
You can see, Tim, I had a half a gallon of water in this gun.
I got one squirt left, and it's got your name on it.
Do you feel lucky, punk? Oh, and Tim squirts the little kid in the face with water.
Dead eye, right in the middle of his forehead, and then and he runs over to mom and like, "What'd you do to my kid?" And I'll be like, "Look at my son." No, anyway.
Yeah, my week has been adventurous. I seeded about boring stories, but I seeded my lawn this year. I went ahead and got a machine to poke holes in the ground, and I put seeds in there. And I told all my neighbors, all of them, I'm going to let my grass grow out because I don't want to mow it too soon and ruin the new seedlings, you know, pull the new grass out. So I've been like getting these dirty stares because, Tim, my grass was like, you could hide a small child.
You're that one neighbor.
Yeah, if a small child would fall into my lawn, it would disappear. But granted, I told all of them what I was doing. I said, "Hey, just a heads up, you know, my grass is going to look really shitty for a good month and a half." And it worked out just perfect because we have gotten nothing but rain the last 2 weeks. So it really helped the lawn really grow quickly. I'm out there cutting it, right? So I got the lawnmower all the way raised up as high as I can get it. It was almost at the point where I thought I was going to have to use the weed whacker first and then come back over with the mower, but I was able to mow it, right? I turn around and I hear this. They're all behind me fucking clapping their hands, dude. I was like, what the fuck is this?
That was the definite TikTok moment. Too bad that one's not circulating on TikTok. That would go viral right now.
I was like, "What the hell, you guys?" It's like, "Oh, wow, they're all just sitting there." Yeah, thank you, thank you, thank you. I was like, "You know, you bastards." I go, I could have been the neighbor, not said anything, and said, "Hey, you know what? I'm just gonna let this grow." But no, I let you guys know I'm seeding it. Because last year, it really took a turn for the worse. It's old grass, so it started dying. I had a lot of dirt patches. So I figured, hey, this winter, it seems like we're getting a lot of rain. This is a good moment for me to seed this. And hopefully it grows back and you know, green and full and beautiful again. And that's what it looked like. But yeah, I swear to God, if one of my little grandkids would have fell in there, I wouldn't have found it for like a week and a half.
Mallory's thinking that you might have had a couple lions out there too that were like crouched down in the grass.
There's a couple of crooked lines in there. Yeah. There's.
I think next year you should just let the shit grow out and then you could just have like neighborhood safaris and then like put some stuffed lion, like stuffed animal lions down in there, a couple rhinoceros or something like that. And just like charge like, you know, $250 and then just drive the neighborhood kids around your high grass backyard and then have your grandkids stand there, you know, like lay down with the stuffed animal and like, you know, like make them jump out of the grass and scare the shit out of everybody. It'd be cheaper than Disney.
Yeah. And the lion approaches the gazelle and just have the lion run.
Oh, yeah. We could get one of the Aussies to fly over and do like the Steve Irwin voice, you know, like, "Hey, we all might."
The lion approaches the gazelle. Gazelle has no clue that the lion is.
Would you look, crikey, would you just look at it? It's an amazing, beautiful animal. Watch out.
You got it. I'll just have you down.
Watch out, you little blokes. You're going to get eaten by the lion.
Oh, my goodness. You know what time it is, Timmy?
Yes, I'm well aware what time it is. We're going to get soft and smooth with you folks. Hey, all you vape boppers out there. We're going to give you a few shout outs for the show tonight. Let's go down the list. I'm calling them vape boppers, vape warriors. They're vape warriors in my mind's eyes. But hey, everybody, and welcome to this week's edition of the Wednesday Night Live Show. After our old man stories, let's get into some names here and see who's joining us on the show. We got the wonderful Mallory Gates leading first, and she's as angry as the rest of us. Well, we're angry. We're angry, but we're happy. Happy and angry that the WHO got a community note today. Who better to get a community note than the WHO? Who else we got in here? We got Rifleman is in the house. Great to see you, Mr. Rifleman. How are you, sir? We got the wonderful local yokel pirate, James R. Kerr is in the house. The beautiful Janine Timmons is joining in. Janine and I were in a race to Warriors come out to play. But anyway, it was a tie, Janine. It was a tie. There's a delay on the show, so I think you and I were like right exactly at the same moment in time. We got Addy Emoji King Tooney in the house. Great to see you, Addy Tooney. How are you, sir? Wonderful to see you always. Who else we got in here? We got Jason Vapes. Actually, Jason, Community Notes Vapes is in the house. Jason, Community were you the one that left the WHO, the Community Note? It was a damn good one if that was you. Who else we got in here? Good to see you, Mr. Jason Vapes. We got, Michael Redfern in the house. Good to see you, Mr. Michael Redfern. How you been? I haven't seen you in a bit. Who else we got here? We got Mark Sliss. Hello, Mark. Hello, everyone. Hello, Mark. How are you? Been a while. How you doing? Who else we got in here? We got Phil Vieira. Phil, I apologize once again. No slight on Clockwork Orange. I know there's some opinions followed. Who else we got in here? We got Granville Porter in the house. Good to see you, Granville. How are you, sir? Yes. He said, what about a hammer of God? Yes, that's exactly. That would be like a Thor moment at the pool to come in with a hammer of God with a 40 millimeter on top of it. Just smoke stacking that thing all the way in. The eyes would turn. It would just be like the Vikings landed. We're here to vape and pillage again. Do you see how I did that? You see that?
I saw that.
Could have led with an R, but I led with a V. Vape and pillage. All right. That's what we're. Best thing ever. And that's it. That's who we got chatting right now. We got 19 watching. So join the conversation. It's a round table today. We're just gonna go more and talk about a bunch of things.
Yeah, I had your sound effect ready to go. No, wait. Where's the one that I have for you? I have one. Oh,
Timmy!
There you go. I love it. It says Timmy. It says Timmy sound effect. No copyright. That's what it says on there.
Yeah, exactly. So we won't get shut down in the blink of an eye for playing that one.
Hey, I tell you, this two years ago, I got a whole section of the show shut down. It wasn't this show, it was the other show, just for using Are You Entertained from the Gladiator movie. How they know that was Russell Crowe's voice. It blows me still away. I mean, and to have that whole section of the show mute it because I chose to play that little sound effect. Are you entertained? So it's a joke. It is a joke. First thing on the agenda, I have it right here.
Hold on one sec. Hey, Dave Ball. Glad to see you on the show. Thanks for jumping in, Dave Ball. Good to see you, buddy. Oh, and there's Stowe. Stowe jumped in too. Stowe's right there. I must have missed Stowe a little earlier. Sorry. Uh-oh. Sorry, Stowe.
Did you get Rifleman too?
I did. I got no Rifleman. I rolled my R's for about half an hour. You must.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, you did.
I hope things are going well in Berlin there, Stowe. Good to see you, buddy.
Yeah. Canada running into some issues too here in the news as well. Trying to ban some more flavors over there. That's weird. Their whole situation is weird. Certain flavors? I'm like, okay, that makes absolutely no sense. So what? Mango's in, but peach is out. Coke is in, so Pepsi's out. It just makes no sense on how they're going about their little flavor ban there in Canada, deciding on who and what flavors get to come through. So we'll dig into that one too. I think I have the link for that.
Maybe we can get a poll vote going on which flavors people think are more kid appealing than others.
Yeah. The ones that like watermelon taffy, maybe, I don't know, but there are people that love watermelon taffy, or like Tim and me who love mango. Oh, right. Real funny, real quick. I do the sports show with Bob, right? And it was just me and Bob the other day. So I go, yes, it's Bob and me, right? Bob goes, no, it's Bob and myself. I go, no, Timmy told me it's Bob and me. And he's like, well, my English teacher. I go, well, Tim's mom's an English teacher and it's Bob and me.
Thank you for defending my aging mother who was 40 years in the school system. But really, there's probably some acceptable options in some of those sentences. but then you would have the proper version. And really, it's just say the sentence to yourself and then think about it a little bit. And when it starts to sound weird, then that's probably because it's wrong.
Yeah. Yeah, Rifleman. I only kind of got a quick glimpse of that article and I kind of read through it real quick. But yeah, it sounds like certain flavors are going to get a pass and some aren't. So how they're going to come to that conclusion on which flavor gets a pass, it'll be interesting news for sure, just to see the process that they're going to go through on deciding which flavors is this mango's okay. Kids don't like mango, right, Tim?
No, kids hate mango. I don't even know why they would even. I mean, it just, you know, just the same.
It's the last time you saw a kid actually eating a mango.
All right, but then again, you know, a lot of adults don't like Brussels sprouts. So, I mean, you know, it's all relative when you think about it. You know?
We don't trust anybody in Canada. New York City sues 11 more vape distributors. This guy here, this mayor. It seems like anytime he runs himself into some trouble, he goes, pulls out the vape card. And he, again, same thing. He's got lawsuits against him. He's got, a sexual harassment suit against him as well. And all of a sudden, we're right back to square one where we were last year, where he has thrown out this new bill that he's trying to get through, pass through. And he's going after, this is what makes me laugh. He's going after vape distributors that are still selling flavors in New York City, which to me, okay, how about getting your law enforcement and your other agencies to go after these shops instead of going after these distributors? Instead of, you know what I'm saying? Enforce the fucking law. If you're still having flavors sold in stores and you know they're still sold in those stores, go after the store.
Okay, but it begs the question, right? I mean, now obviously, if these people are still selling flavors in New York, which right. It's unfortunate that they're in that position anyway, but yeah. I would guess that there's probably some underhanded tactics going on for them to acquire those flavors. Yeah. I agree with you in the sense that I think you would have to look into it, because I think most reputable distributors are not going to knowingly send those products into New York, knowing that there could be some backlash and that their reputation could be damaged in that. So, yes, I do think that you need to enforce the law around the people that are distributing it and work backwards. It's like tech troubleshooting, right? Like, yes, I could go ahead and completely wipe my hard drive and start all over again, but you're probably going to look at some of the issues downstream to try to backtrack to that to figure out exactly, you know, where the problem is. And so, yes, start at the local boots on the ground shop and hold those people accountable.
Yep. April 4th, the New York City Mayor Eric Adams stood at the podium surrounded by city health officials and dedicated anti-vaping activists to announce a lawsuit against 11 companies accused of selling legal flavors, disposable vapes. The event was nearly identical to last year's announcement of legal action against a different group of vape distributors. So this is a new lawsuit similar to the one they had last year, but these are 11 different companies that they're finding are still selling, somehow getting flavored products into New York City. This year's lawsuit filed in the State Court of New York County, Manhattan, is more modest effort than last year's federal lawsuit filed in the U.S. District Court. Like last year's lawsuit, the businesses are accused of violating New York City public health laws, city administrative codes, and public nuisance. How is it a public nuisance?
I don't know. Maybe they like hand delivered it and ran across the state lines naked, yelling, "Here are your vapes. Here are your vapes." Maybe exactly. Maybe that's what
it's
happened.
The Florida man. It's the Florida man.
Go big or go home. Right.
Widely accused of racketeering and wire fraud. So see, that's where I think, you know, if that is truly going on, that's kind of mafiosa shit. With the wire frauding deal, I can get why they would do that process. But what stops a shop owner to say, "Hey, kids, let's get in the car and drive to nearby state where I can buy a box full of disposables and bring them back into to New York and sell them in my shop.
Well, right. You know? And I mean, I think overall, when you look at this at the surface, you know, we can say that, you know, there's, you know, a lot of people doing some things they probably shouldn't be doing. But I also kind of have to open the door to the idea that, you know, public resistance, you know, towards these policies, I think is somewhat justified as well. I'm not endorsing the fact that people are openly breaking the law, but yeah. I mean, really, what are we fighting for here? We're fighting for the right for people to have an adult choice to choose a product that is effectively saving their lives, in more words, less words than more. And so I kind of do have to applaud a little bit the resistance to the, you know, overreaching policies that have robbed people of the ability to, you know, access a product that, you know, is clearly not nearly as dangerous as they would like to make him sound. So.
Yeah. And on top of that, also, I mean, how do they even know that these are legitimate items from these distributors. I mean, they could be bootleg products from China for all they know. So,
well,
I
that mean, may be the angle that they're taking. They could always play it in the sense that, you know, maybe these distributors, if they're legit products coming from legit distributors and they were fooled into thinking they were sending it somewhere and somehow their name gets attached to these products getting into New York City, I think you could probably give them a slap on the hand a little bit and just say, hey, you need to be more careful who you're selling to. But at the same time, maybe that's the angle that they're taking. They're trying to trace it backwards to see if they are illegal black market vapes coming into the circuit and therefore, you know, trying to go after those channels to shut it down. Because, I mean, what's the reality here, right? If you ban it, prohibit it, shut it down and say you can't have it, people are still going to try to get it. And guess who's going to reap the benefits of that? And that's going to be people on the black market. It's going to be distributors and shops doing that, even if it's in the guise of a storefront. It's not just going to be some seedy guy with a trench coat on with, you know, elf bars taped to the inside, you know, just trying to sell on the street. It's going to be, you know, people trying to make hand over fist, non-taxable dough.
Yep. Yep. You know, of course, you're only supposed to be selling tobacco flavored only products in New York City in 2020, just months after New York City passed a similar law. As with most vape bans, in New York, law is widely ignored. No shit, really? And flavored products are easily available in most places. That's the thing. I mean, okay, I'm running into this, you know, here, because in my head, I wanted to, you know, maybe I'm just naive, but in my head, I figured no way I'm going to be able to buy anything flavored anywhere at any place I go into. And it took me a couple months to realize, wait a minute, how's my son have that? Yeah. How's my daughter have that? And then I was running into actual people, you know, at the bowling alley or at the bar or where I was at a restaurant, vaping flavored. I said, where'd you get that? He goes, oh, you know, blah, 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 blah. I'm like, what? I said, really? You just walk? He goes, yeah, just walk in and they're there. I was like, okay. And then I started noticing they were all at all the quick stops and all the, you know, not the legit convenience stores like AMPM, you know, the big boys, 7-Eleven.
Circle K.
Circle K, Wiki, whatever they have on the East Coast. I forget the name of that. What is it?
Well, there's a Wawa, but that's like a regular grocery store, though.
Yeah, yeah. Well, this is kind of like a convenience store, isn't it? Like just an oversized convenience store. You can get breakfast burritos and all that other stuff there. I don't know.
Well, there might be something else, but it must not be in the Southeast because I'm not quite sure. We have QT, Quick Trip. That's one. Yeah. We have the usual BP. You know, the regular gas station stuff, but we still do have quite a few vape shops.
The smaller convenience stores are the mom and pops that are out there. They're like, fine, I walked in and I bought this, and this is the what is this, the Geek Vape one, Geek Bar Pulse, and I was just I was like, okay. I walked in there. I said, well, how much? And they're all $25. And they're right there. They're right there, though, Tim. I mean, there's no hiding them. They're not even trying to hide them. I mean, you walk in, you go to the counter, they're right there. And there's two shelves full of different ones. There's this guy's in there, and he's got this one, and then he's got a stick one. I'm like, how? Number one, how are you still getting them?
Right.
You know, which is, you know, and they're legit because I scanned every one of these. When I got the Geek Bar, I scanned. The first thing I did is I opened the package. I looked for the Q Bar. I scanned it. Legit. So I'm like, okay. But if I go into an AMPM or Circle K or one of the bigger 7-Elevens, there's nowhere to be seen. They have, they do have a vape device there, but it is tobacco. Solely a tobacco product. Let's see. Where is it? And of course they go through a bunch of bullshit. This is what I wanted to talk about, because this is something that he brought up. Part of participants in New York City include most of that. They went into old numbers with teen usage in New York City and in the country, and they dug back instead of using current numbers that we have, we all know now, that are out there. They decided to go the old route and use some of the older numbers to kind of push their point through, and hopefully someone corrected them. Jim doesn't really talk about it in the article. I think he doesn't. Here it is. Nicotine addiction, of course, is not expanding in New York or anywhere else in the country. The use of vape products by middle school and high school students has declined by over 60% since 2019's high. And the past 30 days, cigarette smoking has been under 2% for the 3 years in a row, of only 7.7% of the students who reported vaping on the 2023 National Youth Tobacco Survey. Only about a fourth said they vape daily, under 2% of all students. So those are the current numbers, but they decided to go back to 2019 and throw out those numbers.
Well, that's because they, you know what, I mean, there's a really good chance that the majority of the people that will read that article that have no dog in the fight here really give a damn. They're not going to go research if there's current numbers. They're not going to go, you know, you would think that people would be a little bit more wise, but that's the reality of propaganda and what these people can push. They're going to go ahead and push the most twisted thing that they can put out there, because they know that that's enough to get the gotcha. To Jeffrey's point, you know what's interesting about Brazil here, Jeffrey? My girlfriend is from Brazil, vapes are banned in Brazil, as far as I know. But even though they have a regulation on them and they're technically illegal, they're widely available in stores. Yeah. Like, it's the same kind of gig. Like you can walk into any convenience store, any little shop there in Brazil, and get anything you want. So now, and I don't know if that's just relevant to the importance of focus in that country. But you know, it's interesting to me. So it's not a reach to say that anywhere you go where technically it's not supposed to be, you'll still be able to find it. Only place I never saw it was in Singapore. Singapore, they said no way, and I never saw it.
You go to jail there. You go straight to jail there.
Well, yeah. Well, if you're a Singaporean,
yeah.
I don't know about foreigners, because people apparently there were laws, or there was discriminatory laws in their country about long hair. Because, so just for context, so everybody understands, if you ever hear the myth about don't have long hair in Singapore, they'll throw you in jail. That's a big ass myth. The only reason why it was relevant in Singapore is because
they'll cut your finger off.
So I won't be able to. I'll have to do a reverse middle finger, right? The reason why is many years ago, when the youth was kind of coming to their own and the kids started to rebel, a lot of the younger generation started growing their hair long, and they were perceived as being kind of vagrants and you know, people that wanted to just shake things up and kind of mix up the social environment. So a lot of times those people were moved to the back of the line, or if they even kind of got a little rowdy, they were arrested and thrown in jail. But it's not, it's so not true that if you have long hair in Singapore, that you got to run from the cops the whole time.
Run, dude, run. These are the 11 companies that are named in the lawsuit. Can you see that, Timmy? Because once I move
Would you like me to read it?
Yeah. Once I move it to the other screen to present it, it becomes much smaller for me to read.
Sure, no problem. So the companies named in the city's lawsuit are all located in New York State. That is Environ MD Group, LLC, GT Imports, Kayla Wholesale Incorporated, doing business as The Vapory, Jericho KLCC Wholesale, in Brooklyn, V Trading LLC in Brooklyn, Pioneer Distribution Incorporated, WeVapeUSA.com, Seller Supreme LLC. I guess those are subsidiaries or daughter companies.
Yeah.
That's like umbrellas. RZ Smoke Incorporated in New Hyde Park, Star Zone Incorporated in Oceanside, Urban Smoke Distributors in Woodside, Vape More Incorporated and More LLC in Latham. And Vape Plus Distribution Corp in that's GNA Distribution in Brooklyn.
Brooklyn. So they're all in New York. So I makes me wonder. I don't know. I mean, I loopholes.
And this is not to give away industry secrets or turn people out. But you know, I think, you know, just like we've always been, the vape industry has always been creative in a lot of ways. And so you see, that's what we're seeing there with these subsidiaries and alternate names and all that other stuff. You know, that's not uncommon right now.
Yeah. Hey, Tim, I am going to copy and paste this link and send it to you in private chat.
Yes.
And you can do that one. Let me go to, where's private? Oh, there, private chat.
It's at the bottom.
And this here, is the, yeah, this is the new one, that the Canadian one.
Okay.
I figure we might as well talk about that one. Canada relaunches.
Well, I'm interested in this one. I apologize, folks. Sometimes I get a little wrapped up in a lot of work, and I don't have all day to read vaping articles, so. I apologize. So yeah, let's go over this one. I'm interested in about this one because I'm curious about the discrepancies between which ones they're going to keep and which ones they want gone. So let's share that one. Where is it? Here it is. Canada relaunches. Okay, let's share. All right, cool. All right, so the title of the article is Canada relaunches plan to ban most vape flavors by the wonderful Jim McDonald.
Yeah. Jimmy.
does that guy look trustworthy right there? He's asking the question, why trust us? Well, you got a vape, bro. So I totally trust you, bro. All right. So let's check this out. So it says Canada is on the verge of banning most vape flavors and forcing manufacturers to reformulate existing allowed flavors. Okay, so hold on. So we got to submit a PMTA with a designated flavor profile and mix. And now Canada is going to tell them to go back to the drawing board and re-script their formulations.
Sound familiar, Tim? Sound familiar? Move the goalposts.
That's true, but maybe we'll get into the meat and potatoes of this and understand exactly what changes they're asking for. Maybe they're looking for lower NIC contents or something like that. What? I'm not quite sure. So we'll get there. Reformulate existing allowed flavors using only a short list of ingredients approved by Health Canada. So that probably answers the question right there. So being that mixologists or vape companies, I get that they source a lot of their flavors from the same kinds of places, but maybe they just want specifically regulated, like strawberry flavor. They want it coming from one distributor or lemon, right? Instead of having, you know, 25 flavor houses that can ship you all a different lemon.
But hold on, Tim, but that's what makes one company's flavor that much more unique than the other one is the difference in where they're getting those flavors. So
right.
some may be more intense, some may be more actual flavor or candy flavor. You know how it is. Banana's got like 10 different profiles.
Well, right. So, I mean, just like evolution, right? Animals, humans, everybody adapts with the changing environment. So if it causes some of these vape manufacturers to kind of go back to the drawing board, I guarantee you there'll be some people who will figure out to take whatever's available to them and tweak it a little bit and at least put up a reasonably acceptable product and still stay somewhat competitive if they allow enough to allow companies to be competitive. The new regulations were approved by the government almost 3 years ago, but have lain dormant since then. Unlike most flavored vape bans that prohibit certain flavor descriptors on characterizing flavors, the proposed Health Canada rule will give manufacturers a list of under 100 allowable flavor ingredients and mandate that they only, and mandate that only they be used to create e-liquid. What else are you going to use it for? I mean, if I'm a toothpaste maker, I'm not going to come out with my own brand of vodka. Well, actually, that might be a good deal. Vodka flavored toothpaste. All you suckers in the chat, you'd be lining up to buy that stuff.
Hey, I can promise you, people will be brushing their teeth a little bit more. No, joking.
I'm so ahead of myself. I looked at Jason Vape's comments where he goes, "I'm vaping Castle Long right now." I almost read that as I'm brushing with Castle Long right now. Way to go, Five Ponds. All right. The proposed Health Canada rule will give manufacturers a list of, okay, we read that. And only in tobacco, mint, and menthol.
Yep.
Are there 100 flavors of tobacco?
That's what I was just thinking. Fuck, is there?
Yeah. Well, maybe tobacco. I don't know.
Jack Daniel toothpaste. See what you started.
That's okay. Look, we are vapors. We have creative, visual, vibrant minds, and we can take anything and turn it into a really cool conversation.
I will do anything but Jaegermeister toothpaste. I will not be doing Jaegermeister toothpaste.
You know, on a tangent, I'll get back to the article in a second. But you know what? All the BS that comes out where they're like, oh, you know, if you vape, it's going to like it damage, you know, it can stunt mental growth and all this. And it's going to hurt kids and all this stuff. The majority of the people in this chat, the people that watch the show and get involved with us, have all been vaping for like 5 years or more, let's say. Right. Yeah. You would think within about a 5 to 8 year time span, we would see results of the damage that is caused by vaping. Do you understand that we should? I wish we could be the living experiment to people could see how actually intelligent we are. Like, we're clear thinking, creative, contributing members to society. We're not like this rogue band of zombies, you know, just walking down the street. Like, we're actually, everybody's got, you know, they're smart, they got good jobs, they're, you know, I don't know, I don't get it. We're the example, people. If you want to know what vapors are like in real life, we're a little goofy. Everyone's a little goofy. Anyway, moving on, among flavorings not allowed are sweeteners of any kind. The regulatory agency said in 2021 it estimated 80 to 85% of existing products in the allowed flavor categories would have to be reformulated to meet the new requirements. Additionally, the regulations will prescribe sensory attribute standards to prevent a sensory... Good God, hold on. This is words. This is word salad right here. I need to take a breath before I read this quote.
Okay.
Additionally, the regulations will prescribe sensory attribute standards to prevent a sensory perception other than one that is typical of tobacco or mint menthol. What the fuck does that even mean? They're going to prescribe sensory attributes. Okay, so sensory attributes. So they want the flavor to drive a sensory reaction to it, right?
Yeah.
To prevent a sensory perception other than the one that is typical of tobacco or mint menthol. So what they're trying to do is alter our brains.
Yeah.
Kind of like, you know, that theory, like, you know, when you walk around, you're like, oh, it's cold outside. And they go, well, just imagine you're in Hawaii.
Yeah, right? That works so well.
Yeah. And you're supposed to pretend like all of a sudden, yeah, it's like 80 degrees out and I got a friggin' Mai Tai in my hand or something like that. So that what they want to do is mind control you with a standard that prevents sensory perception.
Yeah.
So they want you to be in the mind frame that you're vaping a tobacco. that, you know, that you're vaping a mint or a menthol other than one that is typical of tobacco, mint or menthol. So what does that mean? You can call it lemon on the bottle, but it tastes like mint. Is that, yeah. Is that, like, what is this a Clockwork Orange? Is this, are we now actually in the movie, a Clockwork Orange? Okay. In other words, manufacturers will be unable to, for example, add caramel to tobacco flavors or fruit flavors to mint. Yep. You can call it whatever you want. So let's just go with it's the cold outside theory. So just put strawberry lemon on the outside of the bottle. Okay. Put mint in the bottle. That's it. Just a mint flavored vape. And then maybe it might work. Maybe you'll think you're vaping a strawberry lemon.
Hey, Janine, we need to move all these people that are making these laws to the middle part of Canada. No, I'm joking.
I got a feeling Janine's sensory attribute will cause them to feel pain from the nether region on up until it results in a collapse on the floor and a rolling around, kind of like a soccer player when he gets, you know, when he gets blown on and then he just takes a dive and he rolls over. Anyway. Five Canadian provinces and territories have already banned flavored vapes. Quebec began enforcing its flavor prohibition last October. New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, the Northwest Territories, and Prince Edward Island already had similar laws. And Nunavut has passed a I'm not Canadian, so if I got that wrong, somebody correct me on that. Nunavut, whatever. Has passed a ban, but not yet set a date for implementation. So vape them while you got them, kids. However, even with all those flavor bans in place, over 70% of Canada's population currently has access to flavors. Great. Mm-hmm. Health Canada's proposed rule will eliminate the most popular flavors across the entire country. And I'm sure a lot of this is under the same guise of this is all about the kids, right? This is all about the kids. We're going to offer up adult flavors, so there is absolutely no way any kid is going to want this kind of crap. Well, I tell you what, I'm here to tell you that it wouldn't matter if you called it poop on a stick.
Yep.
And put a crappy flavor in a bottle. If it's something a kid can catch a buzz off of, they're going to tolerate it. And they'll more than likely do it. But at any rate, this is just more garbage to rob people from their ability to just buy something that helps them disassociate. From
make cigarettes. A choice.
Mm-hmm. The Phantom. Is this the same article? Yes.
Yeah.
The Phantom flavor rule. On June 19th, 2021, Health Canada published new regulations in the Canada Gazette, signifying the government's intention to implement the flavor ban in 6 months. And they're going to, well, this is a flavor ban. This has nothing to do with the reformulations, right? No, how are you going to give a company 6 months to try to reorganize their entire flavor line in 6 months? I mean, people are going to have to put out some stuff that's probably not that great if they're supposed to meet that finish line. And they'll probably hold them to account on that one. Here's what it is now.
Yeah.
And we can't tweak it.
Sorry, this doesn't taste like it used to.
Yeah. Yep. After the obligatory public consultation, vape consumers and businesses steeled themselves for the biggest shakeup the Canadian vape market had seen yet. Then something happened, or rather, nothing happened. Yes. The flavor rule that had been set to launch in January 2022 never appeared, and all Health Canada mentions of a flavor ban or the need for one in documents and social media evaporated. That's kind of like a vapor-related term.
That is
word evaporated. As time passed, vapors began to breathe easier. We're already breathing easier now that we vape.
I thought we were.
Yeah, exactly. As time passed, vapors began to breathe easier. Maybe there would be no flavor ban. They always the false flag, right? They make you think, oh, okay, we're gonna give you the room, we're gonna give it back to you, but no, we're gonna take it away again. In March 2023, even anti-vaping activist group Physicians for a Smoke-Free Canada, major proponents of banning vape flavors, threw up its hands. Oh, they're gotta hate it when the ants are pissed off, you know, like especially when moms against vaping or whatever, parents against vaping, like they think they won.
Yeah.
And then they get, you know, they get shunned.
Do they have the Canadian moms against vaping out there? Is that what they have out there?
I'm sure there's a few out there. I'm sure there's probably some underground cult called that. The tobacco control hardliners published an article speculating that the flavor rule was finished and now seems prudent to conclude that the flavor ban has been left to die on the vine, they lamented. Health Minister Mark Holland, friend of prohibition. This is a guy that you see quite often on X.
Yeah.
Fast forward a year and the flavor ban has returned from the dead, probably thanks to the efforts of one person, newly minted Health Minister Mark Holland. The minister has backing, of course, from the usual special interest tobacco control and medical groups that always oppose consumer nicotine products, including his former employer, Heart and Stroke. Holland worked at Heart and Stroke, formerly called the Heart and Stroke Foundation of Canada, between losing his House of Commons seat in 2011 and taking it back in 2015. Holland is a rising star in the majority Liberal Party, representing a riding district in Ajax, Ontario. Is that where they make the shit for your bathtub, Ajax? Do they make that in Canada? I'm just curious. I don't know. Since being named Minister of Health last summer, Holland has exhibited exactly the sort of anti-tobacco fervor you might expect from the former National Director of Children and Youth at Heart and Stroke. I was with Heart and Stroke when we dealt with the issue of vaping, Holland said at a recent press conference, and there were many voices at that time, not ours. When information was uncertain, who said, let this exist as a cessation tool, don't take action. The result of that, unfortunately, was that the tobacco industry was able to addict a whole new cohort of young people. Has anyone woken any of these politicians up to the idea that we're not big tobacco?
Nope.
Fine. Blame it on big tobacco. Shut them down.
Yeah.
Shut them down. And then you're left with nobody with big tobacco. And that would be the rest of us.
Yeah. Hey, Tim, you got your check, right?
Yes, I did. I got my BT check just the other day. I'm buying a $6.2 million mansion in the hills of Redondo Beach. Ooh. And I'm going to live out a very nice life on my stinky income.
Yeah, mine's all tied up in stock options.
Yeah, well, you know, sometimes that's probably the better place to have it, you know. I mean, it takes money to make money, John.
Yeah, that's
right. Me, I'm just blowing the wad. I'm just going to go.
Mansion, baby.
I'm going for broke. Yep. I'm not going to even lift a pinky. The butler's going to come out with a meat tray, I don't know. Maybe I'll hire like a harem of otters to,
Not the good caviar. I want the good caviar.
Exactly. The result of that, unfortunately, was that the tobacco industry was able to addict a whole new cohort of young people who had no exposure to nicotine to something that's absolutely deadly for their health. Who's died?
Who died? I didn't die.
Who died?
I don't know.
Can someone in Health Canada get me a list of all the people that have died from vaping?
Well, rephrase that. E-liquid, baby.
No, that's what I mean. Yeah, let's put it in a proper context.
You know how they play with our words. They know how they play with our words.
Okay, yeah. So I would like Health Canada to provide a list of all of the people who have died from nicotine vaping. I think that's justified. I think we have the right to ask for that list. If you're going to say something is deadly, let's see the numbers on paper. It has had very injurious outcomes for our health system. There are about 1.8 million vapers in Canada, and the vast majority prefer flavors other than the ones Health Canada intends to allow. That is evidence in and of itself. Flavors matter. It's what adults are using to disassociate from cigarettes, and it's keeping them off of cigarettes because they're able to have an enjoyable product that they could transition to and maintain their ability to stay away from smoking. Yep. So the evidence is right there in their face. Holland has no appreciation of the harm reduction benefits of non-combustible products like vapes and nicotine pouches that serve as consumer alternatives to cigarettes. Everything containing nicotine is, to him, either a cessation product or a deadly tobacco product.
Yeah.
It is hard to imagine how a government official with such a black and white view of nicotine use could steer Canada's vaping policy with any kind of balanced approach. Indeed, he isn't, is not. With no warning to consumers or input from them, health officials invited some vape industry representatives to participate in a desultory stakeholder meetings in March to discuss the revived flavor rule, then apparently began to plow forward with the three-year-old plan. This appears to be a personal legacy project for the Minister of Health, supported strongly by his former peers at the Heart and Stroke Foundation, the Canadian Cancer Society, the Canadian Lung Association, and some smaller anti-smoking NGOs, said Vaping Industry Trade Association Managing Director Thomas Kearsop in a press release. Do we want to keep going? Oh, are we at the bottom here? Okay, we're at the bottom. We're in the finish line. I'm reading fast, kids. Da, 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 da. Big breath. The proposed flavor rule will have a devastating effect on legal consumer vaping choices and will cause irreparable harm to the independent vaping industry, including vape shops. There are about 1.8 million vapers in Canada, and the vast majority prefer flavors other than the ones Health Canada intends to allow. The proposed Health Canada rule will force many back to smoking and will also create a thriving black market of disposable vapes. Make no mistake, Canadians will make every effort to evade a flavor ban, whether through legal or illegal means, writes Concordia University economics professor Ian Irvine in the Financial Post. Legal businesses will be destroyed, as we have seen in Nova Scotia and Quebec. The illegal sector will thrive, and Health Canada will have made Canadians less healthy by reducing the flow of cigarette quitters. How can Canadian vapers and their family and friends register opposition to the government's draconian flavor restrictions? So far, nearly 12,000 vaping consumers have used advocacy group Rights for Vapors website to construct a letter opposing the rules. After you finish,
hold on. I'm putting the link to that in the chat, guys. If you are from Canada, head on over there. So just a heads up, let everybody know that.
Absolutely. Speak your mind, tell your story. You know, voices matter. And I think that, you know, I think at this point in the game, I think to some degree we've all reached a little bit of a level of exhaustion, right? I mean, you know, we feel like that this is stuff that we continue to do and it doesn't seem to garner many results, but I think that integrity matters. And I think that you got to continue to speak up, because at some point the needle will start falling the other way. I think as long as our voices are loud and strong, people at some point will be like, hey, if this clearly matters to people, we can't just push them down. You know, yeah. We can't, you know, we want to try to knock them out of the way, but, you know, your voice matters. So I do think it's relevant. After you finish writing the letter, Rights for Vapors will mail copies to your Member of Parliament, Health Canada, Health Minister Holland, and Associate Health Minister and Minister of Mental Health and Addictions, Yara Sachs, like the department store, right?
I guess.
So, yeah, I clearly this sounds like almost like a mimeographed idea of what they kind of want to do here in America and basically just remove, you know, the desserts and the fruits and the, you know, the Castle Longs and stuff from the vaping sphere. And they think, maybe they think we're stupid, but, you know, just try to offer menial flavored products thinking that, well, if this is such a wonderful harm reduction product, then you, as long as you still have something, whether it be tobacco or mint or menthol, yeah, you know, then you should be happy. It's not gone. We're still letting you have it, just not in the, you know, the multi-layered mango, orange, tangerine, lychee flavor.
Don't say lychee. God.
Well, I can say it. I just will never vape it.
Yeah, we'll never vape it. Yeah.
So there's that. I'm curious. I mean, what do people think about this? How do you feel about this in general terms? Are you seeing this as a glass half full, glass half empty? Does this leave a window to opportunity open to the vaping industry and our journey that, you know, is in front of us right now? I mean, obviously, I think we don't want to accept the fact that it's going to get worse before it gets better. But at the same time, you know, there's something that's still out there. So there's still hope. There's still the ability for people to get these products into their hands and maybe find a way to get attached to something that's proven to be safer for them in the long run Whereas taking it completely away, you know, just thrusts us into a black market scenario, right? So there'll be products available, but people aren't really necessarily going to know what they're getting, where they're getting it. So should we be a little happy that something's still out there? My feeling is no. I don't want to accept that, but at the same time, you know, I want to say, well, you know, at least for the accidental quitter, there's still something that's accessible. I mean, here in America, they're talking about taking away the mints and the menthols too, and leaving us with only tobacco flavors. So I think, you know, that's even more horrific than anything.
Yeah. Let me go through some of these here. Rifleman.
Absolutely, James. Yes. Australia should be on the top of that list. Well, Australia, you guys got, you know, what they say, they always F you at the drive-through. Is that the thing? Yeah, you didn't even get like half the stuff you ordered anymore.
Yeah.
Probably got some wilted piece of lettuce in a bag, and that was about it.
Bun with nothing in it. Just a bun. Taco with no, just a shell.
Flavorless air in a bag.
Here's your bag of nothing.
Yeah. And you need a prescription for that.
Oh, yeah. You got to have that prescription for that. I am going to jump and do. Good night,
Janine.
Good night, Janine. I'll go ahead and do a feel good story real quick.
Yeah.
Let me get that out of the way. Let me make sure I hit the right button. Here we go. Tell me something good. Tell me that you love me. All right. This is the article right here. Florida police officer complete grocery delivery after arresting the delivery driver. I don't want to watch the video, but that's where the link is in the chat or header of the show. This is funny. Because, only reason is because I don't know if anyone follows Nick Orlando on Facebook, but he posted today that his wife had gotten a flat tire and there was some police behind her and they didn't try to help her or do anything. They just kind of stood there and looked at her. Nick showed up and Nick changed the tire for her. Again, no help, no nothing, no, hey, is there anything we can do? Just completely ignored Nick's wife. But it was funny that, and then I read this article and I'm like, oh, okay, this is a little different Florida. Let me get to the story here. Suspect Richard Robinson, 40, was wanted on felony charges both in Florida and Texas. Officers who spotted his plate numbers and pulled him over confirmed his identity and also noticed that he had a large delivery order in his car, Tim. having finished the protect part of their job, they switched over to the service part of their job. I like the way the guy wrote this. Kind of cool. Which had a woman in a home remarking that she would make sure the officers received Robinson's tip. They tipped them. They tipped the cops. How hilarious! How hilarious is that?
20%. 20% is like,
I don't know. I don't know. But when they do the tip, it's automatically through the app, so the dude gets the tip that they arrested it. Maybe you can use that for.
I think, you know, some of them now actually offer you the opportunity to give a cash tip when they come to your door. Now I know that like Uber Eats and DoorDash, they want the tip up front, which I. You know, I think I can pretty much trust somebody to drop some food off at my house. They didn't make it. So,
yeah. I have a hard time with the food part. That's the one part. After seeing so many shady videos of people drinking your soda, eating your fries and all that other stuff, I'm kind of hesitant to order food to be delivered to my house. I know it doesn't happen all the time, but you know what I'm saying? Arriving at the house, the policewoman rang the doorbell. How funny is that? You see your doorbell ringer thing come up on your TV. You see two cops holding grocery bags. And what do you do?
Yeah, exactly.
captured the Ring camera on the door and shared to social media, showing her not nodding with a smile on her face. Funny, while waiting for the answer, my dad was a police officer when I was growing up, so I have the utmost respect for them. So when I saw that, it was wonderful to see, said, I don't even know how to say her name, N-E-U.
New.
New. Yeah, that was her name. That's the story. That's the whole story. I just thought it was a funny story. You know, I could just imagine. I mean, they could have went a whole different route with that. They could have just took the food back to the supermarket or took it back to the police station. But, you know, kind of cool that they said, hey, you know what? You know, we should. It's a lot of groceries. Some family's waiting for this food. Let's go ahead and deliver it.
Well, I guess how I look at it, like, I think that, you know, I'd like to believe that there's good in everyone, but I also sort of live by the general standard that, you know, treat people the way you would want to be treated. So maybe that cop was thinking, you know, if that happened to my delivery driver, you know, I would want, you know, like, it would be a cool thing if the person was a good person and still brought me my food. So he was probably thinking like that, you know, pay it forward kind of thing. So good on the cop for completing the delivery. He got his arrest. He, you know, he was able to fill out part of his quota sheet. So, you know, hey, you know.
He, you know, protected, why not? I mean, and he served him.
Exactly. Well, I mean, you see stories similar to this. I've seen ones like, you know, where the one police officer, he got involved in, I know this is not vaping related, folks, stay with us for just a second. Yeah. But, you know, there was a bunch of kids who were playing basketball out in the street because they didn't really have anywhere else to play basketball. So they set up like a net on the side of the road. And then, of course, you know, there's always one or two Karens in the neighborhood who were complaining because it violates HOA rules or whatever they want to go after. They didn't like these kids hooping and hollering out in the street. So they, of course, they called the police, and the police came out to see what was going on. And of course the kids weren't doing anything wrong. They weren't like playing, they weren't like holding, you know, 45s in one hand and shooting with the left. They weren't shooting jumpers. They were doing kid things, keeping their noses clean, playing basketball. The cop really couldn't do anything about it because they were not violating anything legally by playing basketball. And so what did the cop do? I mean, I think he probably had to at least tell them, hey, or, you know, at least kind of, you know, tell them to calm down, whatever. So then he comes back like a day later and he brings like Shaq with him to play basketball with.
Yeah.
I mean? So there's a lot of, you know, there are people out there who, you know, do recognize that, you know, there could be worse things going on in this world than to chastise a bunch of kids about playing basketball. So good on the cop for bringing the food.
Yeah, they're not Tim sitting on his lawn chair on his lawn with his super squirter telling kids to move on down.
I'm locked and loaded. I'm ready for them little whippersnappers to come on by.
Stay off my lawn. And Jason, hey, you get this, buddy. Yeah, baby. Zero pineapple, baby. That's what I want to hear. That's
our hero. You were one of our friends posted that the Undertaker, the wrestler, had a sign up that said pineapple belongs on pizza, and the comment was the Undertaker really knows his pizza or something like that. And then I posted and I said the Undertaker is clinically insane.
That's right. He probably is. Screw that guy. Of course. Go ahead, Tim.
No, I was saying that, you know, definitely. I mean, anybody who legitimately thinks pineapple belongs on pizza, I think you need to go be seen. You need to be seen.
You need help. You need to sit on a couch for an hour, 45 minutes, whatever the standard time now is for psychiatrists.
Yeah. Go have a mango vape and call us in the morning. Call us in the morning.
Mango vape. And of course, those of you that follow me on Twitter, you got to see this one, which made me smile. It says how the tables have turned, and it's the pizza on top of the pineapple, baby.
But I see what you did there, and you can't fool us. You cannot fool us. You think that you can flip it around, smack down, flip it and reverse it, and then somehow we're gonna fall for that. Hell no. That's the same combination.
It'd be rough eating that, though, for sure.
So let's briefly talk about this one success that popped up here. I want to, if anybody hasn't seen this yet, I just want to share this one real quick We don't necessarily have to get into all the where to fours about it, but I just mentioned it at the big of the show at the beginning of the show.
I agree with you, Mallory.
Yep. I got to check my messages. I think Mallory sent me something too, so I want to check on that real quick. But here it is, folks, in all of its glory. Take a look. Let me make it bigger because nobody can see it.
That's what she said.
Let me make that one 200% because it's worthy of at least 175. So the World Health Organization just put out this article. I don't know. Has anybody's teeth fallen out of their face? Is anybody losing their hair? Anybody experiencing
ED?
ED? Anybody
popcorn
having
lungs?
Yeah. Are you coughing up popcorn while you're sitting there watching, doing your Netflix and chill? So again, here we are, the leaders in health information and globally across the world have now made the claim that vaping increases your risk of seizures typically within 24 hours of doing it. How many people here are having seizures every hour, uncontrollable seizures at that, from vaping? Now, I know that in your 8 to 10 year vaping experience, even four or five, how many people can honestly raise their hand and say that they have just been seizuring all over the place? Like, your family is constantly shoving a wallet in your mouth so you won't swallow your tongue. Can I get a show of hands?
I'm just laughing at Mallory's comment.
Just as I suspected, zero. So anyway, they got a good old community note on this one that says this post is based on inconclusive evidence utilizing studies that have not been peer reviewed. The claim is based on approximately 120 incidents that occurred since 2019. 120.
Yeah.
120 out of how many millions of vapors?
Yeah.
How can you even make that claim? I would think if you're going to have an isolated study with results,
yeah,
that you would have to be able to put that number up against the entirety of the known number of vapors and say that this is about as possible as one of those little hoverboard things that all the kids love for Christmas, like catching on fire in your house. Yeah. About as dangerous as a vape blowing up in your pocket. And what do we know about that? We know that most of the time, the vast majority of those cases, somebody was doing something wrong. So did they look at all of the general information around these particular cases of 120 people? And let's be realistic, right? In the same breath, different products affect people differently too. I mean, I'm sure there's people that are allergic to PG or VG. So what now? Are you going to say that vaping with PG and VG you're more likely to have an allergic reaction, and your throat will close up or something like that? Like, I mean, come on. You know, I know people that can't eat, you know, peanut butter and stuff.
Peanuts. Yeah.
Peanut butter. So, I mean,
gluten's a new one, Timmy.
Of course, the gluten-free. Bleh, bleh, bleh. I had a gluten-free muffin, and basically, I imagine it tasting almost exactly like what dog food tastes like to a human.
Well, you know, you've eaten a little dog food in your life. You had to try it.
Well, right, and to Dave's point, being in a concert with a fog machine would have been the same result. And I think everybody remembers years ago the study that was done in the vape shop where they went in and measured air quality. They walked into a vape shop, which basically is reminiscent of like an old accounting office in like 1935, you know, where everyone's wearing, you know, green visored half hats and there's smoke everywhere. And they measured the air quality of the vape shop, and the measurements were so micronic as to the contaminants in the air.
It was actually better than the outside air. And it was over 1,100 vape shops in California through that test. So it was a big, big test. So,
right. I mean, So, I mean, it's just kind of ludicrous that they come out and it just infuriates me that they can come out and make these claims and say these things about this particular product when the evidence is surrounding them that absolutely refutes that. follow the science. I mean, okay, anecdotal if you want to call it, but I don't think it's as anecdotal as you, one might might think. I mean, we're living proof that those particular during a vape comp. Yep, it could be. I don't know. Maybe the guy seizured out because he lost. Maybe
I thought he was going with that one time at band camp thingy.
Yeah, exactly. Maybe he was so distraught because he lost his vape comp. He didn't saturate enough, and he got overwhelmed. Started having heart palpitations because he had to go home to his wife and tell her how he didn't win the $250
and the gift card to fucking Subway.
Exactly, and you know he just. Just started shivering on the floor. You know, people had to hold him down. Don't let him hurt himself.
To hold him down.
Too. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Don't let, you know, well, they say when people have seizures, don't hold them. Don't hold them. Yeah. I had a dog that was epileptic for 6 years that he had grand mal, and I got hit in the face several times. When you take a 90-pound dog claw to your face, full force, that hurts. But anyway, so I mean, just another one of these things. I love this community notes thing. I'm hoping that the integrity behind community notes remains. I hope that, you know, the tool that has been given for people to be able to put valid information up on these posts, the integrity stays there because it is valid, because we should be allowed the counter argument. And this is something that can't go away. Yeah. They literally cannot get rid of this community note now. So it's going to follow this post forever. Now what, another opinion question to the people in chat and to you, John.
Yes, sir.
If you're just somebody out on Twitter, I mean, or let's call it Twitter, it's X, but you know, and these posts come up, obviously I think the average person probably is more inclined to lean towards reading about something that fits their own personal agenda, right? True. So that would mean that the percentage of people that would stick with this post or read this article would be people who want to hear something bad about vaping because they're just waiting to hear something bad about vaping. Do you think that they're quick to dismiss these community notes, or do you think that this is something that is beneficial, that they will go so far as to read the community note and take some consideration regarding the community note, just to say,
I would hope so. You know, I would hope so. I think that a lot of times we, you know, people get tired of reading articles from you know, from professionals that are always attacking, and then when you get someone that comes in there and is you know, and states that, hey, I'm a 10-year vapor, I have had no issues. I think I would be more likely to read it if I weren't involved, just to kind of to see the other side of the story. I hope people are like that. I mean, I'm hoping people are like that, but there are people that are out there that are like we talked about. They're headline readers. You know, they don't dive into articles. You know, they read the headlines and then they feel like they've read the whole article. I can't stand those people.
Yep. No, I mean, I'm hoping that this is a mechanism to get people to kind of read the counter comment and just at least compare apples to oranges to see what the community note is about. I believe that these community notes hold some value. I hope that it doesn't somehow.
Is there a back and forth with experts when we do? That's what I'm kind of interested. So if I were to go write something in there, am I going to get a response from someone at the WHO or some professional that's going to try to contradict what I'm saying?
Well, I mean, I think that's the conversation about having a debate. I mean, if you're going to go ahead and make a claim, right? I mean, they're going to throw this article up and say that these studies were done to prove this or whatever. You know, they want their information to stand. And then if someone's going to be able to post a community note that refutes that or at least debates that, you know, I think if you're an honest person, you're going to want to see both sides of the argument, right? There's this side of the story and there's this side of the story. And somewhere in the middle, there's some truth, right?
Yeah.
So you think a genuine critical thinking person. So my question would be to Jason Vapes. Jason Vapes, you've been approved to be a community notes contributor. Is there any unique criteria to creating a community note that lets its legitimacy stand up? Like, what is the general requirement that you have to put in there? Obviously, you can't just make a counter statement and just end at the post is based on inconclusive evidence and leave it at a sentence. Are you required to put links to the sources in there to prove exactly what the evidence-based statement is that you community note? Accurate sources. Okay. So, right. You can't just, they can't be some willy-nilly back pocket rag that has an opinion piece out there, with nothing that actually has studies or proof. Yes. Links. There you go. Okay.
Nice.
So that's good. So I like that idea. And then obviously there's an approval process. Jason brought that up as well. So that, you know, you can't just submit it and it instantly shows up. There's some kind of a validation process somewhere in the middle where they're checking to make sure that the information put up is valid. Anyway, I just thought that was cool that the big boys got stamped.
Yeah. And people can downvote, he says, if your post is a shit source.
Okay. Yeah, so I like this part about it too. And I've taken part in many of these community notes from this perspective here, where you can rate it, and then it goes in and it asks you, you know, kind of like a customer
survey.
Survey type questions to state whether or not, you know. So you know, obviously this is something we, as vapors, we can jump on, and we can certainly rate those comments up, and then, you know, probably prevent them, because I'm sure that if that's getting a lot of downvotes, that maybe they look a little deeper into it, or maybe potentially take it down. I mean, I'm sure that's under the control of X, but that was kind of an interesting one. I thought that was kind of cool.
Okay, cool, Jason. Thank you.
Yeah, that helped out.
Yeah, it does help out. It does help out. Like I said, too, it'd be, you know, hopefully our inner circle, outside of our inner circle, reads these. And that's what we're hoping for. I mean, that's the bottom line. We can continue reading these and sending information to these notes. But we're hoping that people outside of our little circle, whether it's the vaping circle or the WHO circle, I actually take some time to read some of these notes and at least, you know, have a second opinion put in front of them.
Well,
go ahead, Tim.
Oh, I was just going to say, I mean, from my perspective, looking at it, I hope that, you know, I mean, people that read those, you know, can see the counter arguments and maybe make them have a little bit more of an outlook on things, like, you know, hey, what am I voting for here? What exactly am I doing? Who am I putting in office? So if these things go up and then they read these community notes, especially if it's coming from someone in government, you know, somebody who, you know, is a senator or something like that, and then they get community noted often, you know, then, you know, their constituents might be a little bit more inclined to go, well, hey, if he's not necessarily telling me the truth about this, is he telling me the truth about that? And maybe just it's a guilt by association kind of response, you know?
Yeah.
Well, we're happy to have you here, Aaron. Yeah, we love having you here. Yeah. We don't want to make it boring for people.
We like seeing new faces all the time. We do. I love this. The powerful U.S. House Oversight and Accountability Committee has announced a hearing that will examine the Food and Drug Administration's FDA with community members questionnaire. The FDA Commissioner Robert Caff, right? That's how you say it? Caff? Caffey? How do you say his last name?
Spell it.
C-A-L-I-F-F-F.
Caliph
will face a scrutiny of a wide variety of topics, including the agency's tobacco and nicotine product. I thought this was just solely about tobacco and vapes, but I guess they're throwing everything in there. I guess he's being questioned on many things here. What is he? He's being the formula crisis with the kids, infants, formula crisis, the food safety, drug shortage, inspection, hemp regulations on tobacco and nicotine products, and over-the-counter decongestants. I guess we have a problem with decongestants out there, Tim. Did you know? Are you aware of that?
Well, John, if I'm not mistaken, if I'm not mistaken, I think decongestants are a source of a byproduct that causes trailers to blow up every so often.
I know it does. You cannot go into the store and buy 20 bottles.
Nope. That shit's behind the counter now, kids. You're regulated.
Well, yeah, and this hearing scheduled for actually tomorrow, April 11th at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, will be streamed live on, let me click this link. It's going to be streamed live on YouTube. So hopefully, fingers crossed, that the chat is open during this. Who knows? I don't know if it is or isn't open. But if the chat is open, it'd be interesting to just read the chat in that thing. So I'm going to put the link in our chat there, and that'll take you to the oversight of the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, and it'll take you to their YouTube channel, and you'll be able to watch that live Thursday, April 11th at 1 p.m. Eastern time. I'm wondering how much of us is going to be in this hearing. What would you say, Tim? How much do you think they're actually going to talk about vaping and put the hammer or the pressure on Mr. FDA man? What's his name again? Robert Califf.
I don't know. I always feel like our representation is somewhat marginalized the majority of the time. I think that the inquiring minds are padded from hearing information that the government doesn't want them to get exposed to. So they would rather just sort of like give us some, a few scraps on the floor and let us sort of speak our mind, but make us look like a bunch of wackadoos in the corner that have no idea what we're talking about. I think that they'll probably allow a little bit of it in, but we see what happens in all of these particular things. There's always a few loud dissenting voices that make really good points about things and actually state the truth. But I think that they try to bully us back down and just, kind of say, you know what, kid, go sit in your corner again. You're talking nonsense. We know what's best for you.
Well, they've got a couple big boys in there. The infant formula crisis, that's going to be a huge one, I'm sure. And we're not downplaying all these other things that are on their agenda. I mean, those things are important, but I'm just kind of curious to how important we are to the oversight committee and forcing them to figure out some sort of solution for the vaping industry. And like I said, we're going up against that. We're going up against food and drug shortages and, facility inspections, hemp regulations. And then we're the last thing on there. Of course, decongestants are the last thing that's on there, but it just makes me more. I'm hoping that the chat is opened on that. I doubt it though. What do you think?
I'm sure it'll be moderated and things of that nature. I mean, they always sort of like, they keep a strong rap on, the freedom of speech and people having, an open opinion about things. I mean, they probably, still sort of take that approach that we're just basically a bunch of trolls and bots and that we're just there to stir up trouble and we get our friends to gang up on everybody. And no, that's really not the aim. I mean, yes, we're frustrated. Yes, we're mad. Yes, we're upset. I think we have the right to be. But at the same time, they try to make us look like court jesters, that we're just a nuisance, and we're just, a few loud voices that just want to, not detract from the actual real information, misleading. We're misleading the public in their eyes. And we're not. We're just saying, hey, look, we're not even like if you actually sat down with us, the vast majority of us would sit there and probably agree on a lot of those similar points that, yes, we agree that kids should not have access to vaping products. We certainly don't want them vaping. We understand that this is an adult product that was designed for adults who had one specific result in mind, and that was is to find a product that worked for them to get them away from smoking. But they ignore that completely and just think that we're a bunch of fools that have just somehow, you know, like all we do is stand in front of the refrigerator and open and close it constantly just to make sure the light is really on or off, you know, or something like the myth of the light that stays on when you shut the door kind of thing. And it irritates me because I just think that there are a lot of very well-educated, very smart people who have a lot to contribute to the conversation. And those voices should be taken at worth and not just dismissed as these anecdotal people who are just grabbing, you know, information out of their ass.
And Addy says that it is going to be disabled, which I was betting it would be disabled. And you like my I'm not a robot logo now? I found that one. I thought it was
I loved your post the other day. Just wanted to remind everybody, just in case you were wondering, I'm not a robot. But you see how quick they dismiss us? Like when we first all ran over to Twitter because, you know, they were told that's the best place to go and get your voice heard because the actual people are creating these posts and they're following this information. I would say probably 95% of the time the bastards never respond. They don't actually engage in conversation with you, but it's a nice platform to be able to put some counter information.
And I hope so, Jason, because I think there, you know, I've never seen any one of these, but I'm assuming there's going to be people there interested in some of the other topics that they're going to be discussing, and they'll get a good mouthful of what's going on in our and maybe hopefully a percentage of those people take the time to do a little research. Yeah. You know, what is going on with vaping? Why is flavor such a big deal? So it could be helpful, could be negative, but hopefully they do. Like I said, they discuss it and force the FDA to make some sort of move, man.
I think what's fair is fair, and I think, you know, we deserve that in this world. I mean, there's a lot of bad shit going on, and there's a lot of things that we can be absolutely concerned about. But I think that you have to be fair, and we have to look at it from both sides of the argument and realize that, you know, that fair regulation seems reasonable.
Yeah.
But just not this bullshit prohibition crap. Yeah. Hey, Mallory sent me a really interesting link. I thought this would be cool to share with everybody, and we can kind of go over it together, right? Because we talk about
we're a family.
We're a family. Well, we talk about, you know, the where the world is and its stance on vaping, and it was a really cool thing. So I'm going to share this one, and we'll go over the data that's listed here. It's a very interesting chart. It's very visual for all you visual people. You know, where like me, like I can't stand.
Timmy,
I can't.
I like pictures, Timmy.
I can't stand a book unless there's a picture like every other page, right?
I still like the pop-ups. I still love my pop-up books, man.
Oh, remember, man, those were my favorite.
Remember
those
your first favorite one? You were like,
no, you wanted. Well, pop-up books were great when you were like from like 3 years old to maybe like 8, 9 or 10, right? Like, you know, that was your pocket. When I got hooked was when that you could go to all the gas stations and the roadside kind of like five and dime shops and get those ad lib books.
Yeah.
The ones that, you know, had the little pen in it that would, like, you know, where you could uncover all the invisible stuff, like, you know, and you could play all those games in the car. But ad libs, oh, that was amazing. High school, best years of my life with the ad lib book. All right, hold on 1 second. Okay, hold on. Okay, this is called the ranking. It's basically the global index of supporting vaping and tobacco harm reduction by country, by region. So the 2024 effective anti-smoking policies global index ranks countries representing a massive 5.5 billion people.
Woo!
A staggering 69% of the world's population. By offering both overall rankings and product specific assessments, the index provides, is that a word? The index provides? Can
only
I play that
one? Only you would know.
You know what? I'm thinking that one would be a dagger in Scrabble. Like, if you could come up with that one, like, it's over. Like, you could play that word first.
That's 11 points.
That's like 300 points just right out of the gate. And then your opponent's just looking at you with ire the rest of the evening. Although I wish you could have that many letters, you'd never be able to spell that one unless somebody was had a slip up and they put enough in there so that you could connect the dots on that one. The index provides a crucial roadmap for countries to identify areas for improvement and learn. No, this is a person who didn't proofread their article. Nope. That's what this is. Yeah, you need a copy editor when you're going to put this stuff online.
You need a Tim.
Because yeah, I can tell you without a doubt, and learn is not a word. And his learn
services,
is not a word.
His services are available. Contact Tim at.
Yeah, yeah. You didn't spellcheck.com.
.com.
All right. From effective policies adopted worldwide. So they kind of put this cool little chart. It's obviously color rated. I think the lighter colors or the whited out ones means that there's very little support in those particular countries. We're all kind of aware of this anyway.
Yeah.
But I just thought it would be cool to look at the ranking system. So it said for the U.S., in the U.S. anti-smoking approach, that's ES. In the U.S., the anti-smoking approaches, oh, no, it's two words. Approach is marked by contradictions. And Sweden emerges as a notably open country. Australia down under, down on anti-smoking. Brazil cracks down on vaping and heated tobacco and complete bans. So as you see, the colors start to wane. That usually means that there's less support. So, of course, number one coming in strong. UK.
Look at that number just going up and up. It was just.
Yep. That looks like our deficit number on the billboard as you're driving down the road. Maintains global leadership with progressive stance on innovative nicotine products, improved regulation for heated tobacco, and recognition of nicotine pouches as harm reduction tools. So it's hard to read, but if with vaping, they're at 100. 100, they rank 100 with support. Heated tobacco products are around 93%. Snus, very low, zero. They don't support snus in the UK. But nicotine pouches, they're okay with. That one is around 70.625. So about 71% ranking on that one. So you can do it by region, Asia, Africa, Asia, Oceania. Yeah. Then we can look at the global numbers. All right. So they break it down by all four categories. So,
oh, wow.
So global, let's look at world. Okay, let's go by world. So the global index for UK, England is at 92.83 in terms of support. So across the board, we already covered these numbers. They definitely support vaping. We know this. Tobacco heated products, 92.5. Nicotine pouches is at around 70.62 in terms of ranking.
I was
support.
Surprised that Czech Republic was so high. You know.
Okay, but I mean, the Czech Republic, I mean, you don't really hear too many stories.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, now, I guess my question here is this generally representative of support versus availability?
Yeah.
So, I mean, you could support something in a country, but the government could say you can't have it.
Right.
So, even though the government's outnumbered, we know who holds the gavel, right? So with that, Sweden still seems kind of high up on the ranking list. They're okay with vaping. They're pretty okay with tobacco heated products and of course snus. And then, you know, well, it's cause that's their home run right there.
Yeah.
And nicotine pouches, 95.75. So, I mean, Sweden is about right where I expect them to be. Slovakia, Ireland, snus seems to be the one that kind of has the most controversy around it.
Yeah,
they either
surprised too though. In Switzerland, it's such a huge product, right?
Yeah, but they're okay with. Well, yeah, they're okay with this. Switzerland's okay. At around 87%. So I mean, yeah. In the countries where it is recognized and allowed to be used, you know, you'll see that the support numbers are there. But it's kind of interesting to me that you know there's certain countries that just want nothing to do with it. Like they just don't. I don't know enough about snus. To really comment on it. I've never tried it. I've never had it. I've never seen it. I mean, only in pictures and stuff like that. So I'd like to maybe do some more personal research on exactly why the stance is so stark. You know, it's like you don't see like 30%, 40%, then some 80s and then some 90s. It's going from like 80, almost 90 to zero.
Right.
From country
right.
to country.
Well, Lebanon. What is it for the United States? It's what is it for the United States? 86%.
So here's the ranking. So we're ninth on the list.
First
we rank So we rank 87th. For support on SNUS. We're pretty consistent across the board. But if you were to look at the news and everything going around, you would think that those numbers wouldn't even be anywhere close to that.
Yeah.
Spain. Yeah. Again, not fans of SNUS. New Zealand. Definitely not pouches. Definitely not SNUS. Romania. So, I mean, the numbers are pretty high for most people. Call out a country. We can take a look at it. Poland, Croatia, Austria, Ukraine, Bolivia. I would expect it to start to see these numbers kind of wane as the list goes down. So, I mean, you would start to see a bit of a drop. I mean, was India in there? India's probably at the bottom.
India's zero.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, Peru, Indonesia, the Dominican Republic, they are waning a little bit. UAE, now, I think it only more recently became legalized in the UAE, because when I went to Dubai, you were not allowed to bring it into the country. So I, unfortunately, went back to smoking in that during those trips, just because I was too afraid to get whatever I had confiscated at the border.
And put in prison.
Yep. But the moment I got inside the door, you know, you'd be at the bar, and there's some guy with an open system right there. Now
in Dubai, he was a prince.
he very well could have been. He was in a lot nicer suit than I was in. I can tell
you
that.
He was a member of the royal family, which is like 1,000 people, right?
Yes, well, Rifleman, that's what we're kind of saying. We're trying to understand what the relationship here is. So, I mean, this is a support ranking, but that may not necessarily mean access to the product. Does that make sense? I think that's kind of what this is showing. So, the legal status is questionable. I don't know of a convenience store where I can walk in and find SNUS.
Yeah. There's one here. I've seen it on the shelves, but I never considered even trying it. But maybe I will, just for scientific purposes for the show.
Well, and then look at this contradiction here. Now you've got countries like Malaysia where they're a forcedness, but they aren't for nicotine pouches.
Right.
So explain to me why you don't support a nicotine pouch. But this has nicotine in it. Yeah, this has nicotine in it. This has nicotine in it. What maybe made that?
Maybe it's been misused there. I don't know.
Could be. I don't know. Maybe they've got some extraction.
Everybody's got a friend that's got like three patches on and he's smoking a cigarette. We all have that friend.
Yep. Now, but the interesting part here, though, to that point, Rifleman, is that I don't think that tobacco heated products are really a widely available, like the IQOS. I think it was on shelves and then they pulled it off the shelves. So, I mean, it's not really, I don't see anybody with them. So if there's an alternate product out there that anybody can use with regard to heat, not burn, I have not seen anybody with one, nor do I know anybody that's like, oh yeah, I tried it and it's awesome.
Yeah.
I think for most people that see them, I think the image there is like you're smoking a cigarette. That's how I feel when I see the little stubby, like butt thing sticking out of the end with the filter on it. It looks like I'm smoking a big fat cigarette. I don't know.
How it's largely available in the U.S.
I don't know. And then like, so Japan, down with vaping, down with snus. But they're okay with pouches and heat not burn. Now, we know that was a kind of a thing in Japan. They fully endorsed that. They were behind that 110%, almost 100%. Uruguay. Here's all the zeros for vaping now. Now they're all starting to show up. And you can see their rankings are very low across the board anyway, even though they have some spikes here and there with regard to certain products that they support. But it, once again, do the people have access to those products?
Yeah.
Who's to say? Real low, Venezuela, Argentina, Norway, pretty much a snus country.
Well, Mexico, well, shit, I've never seen even anyone, Spanish or Mexican, whatever you want to call them, here in California, like using snuff. And that's what, 58%?
Where? Mexico?
Yeah.
Well, okay, but again,
it's weird.
I'm looking at
zero patches, zero vaping.
Well, not patches, pouches.
Pouches.
Yep.
But 50, yeah, I've never seen anybody, and I have a lot of Mexican friends never brought up snuff. I've seen them smoking cigarettes, but I've never seen anyone using snuff. That's just a weird number.
Yeah, but I would love to see the counter ranking with regard to combustible cigarettes on this list.
Yeah, yeah.
I would like to see what they're supported for that. What watch them all be suspiciously very low.
Yeah.
So anyway, we get into the goose eggs across the board. So Australia, we know. India, we know. Qatar, interesting to me. Interesting that Qatar is this way because they're a Middle Eastern country, and typically those countries have that social environment where, you know, some kind of, you know, hookah is very, very popular and things of that nature. Yeah. So, you know, you would think that there would be some support in those countries for alternatives or other things, but that could be a cultural traditional thing. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Thailand, zippy. Turkmenistan. I didn't even know that was a country. So next time I watch the Olympics, I'm going to be looking out for the Turkmenistan team because I don't even know who you are. Vietnam, zippy. But very interesting chart ranking.
Vietnam. Yeah, they were talking about executing people there. So.
Yeah, but you know what? You know what's interesting to me in countries like that where they have such strict kind of martial law tactics and some stuff like that, like people still will risk their lives to get it, use it, whatever. Yeah. It's like you would think that would be enough a deterrent. You know, like if, you know, it was, you know, like Sharia or something where it's like if you were caught vaping, you're going to lose your tongue and a hand. I'd be like, where'd my mango vape?
You better be very flexible so you can use your toes to hold that cigarette.
Exactly. Like, cat got your tongue? No. Short little dude down the road. The vape cop down the road got me.
He said I can have it back if I pay the fine.
Yeah, that's interesting. But I like how you can break it down. Like if you want to focus the rankings, you can go by region. Yeah. So you can look at the Americas and see exactly where they are. So it kind of dwindles down when you get to Argentina, Brazil, Chile. It's not Chile. It's Chile. You eat Chile. You visit Chile, Mexico, Nicaragua, Panama, Uruguay, Venezuela. North and South America, folks. North and South. Yeah, don't worry. You won't wake up tomorrow and Venezuela is the next state over. Okay, just letting you know. I don't know the globe that well, but I can pretty much figure that one out.
So. Hey, Jason, have a good night, buddy.
Thanks, Jason. Appreciate you being here all the time, every time.
Yeah, thanks for the info, too, on the community notes there.
Yes, sir. I'm standing by waiting for more. All right. We want to move on to you have another article? I got another one.
I wanted to talk a little bit about these.
Yeah, let's talk about them. Let's do it. Let me stop sharing. Let's talk about because I think I have something to add to the conversation because I have recently been gotcha'd by the disposable bug. So
all right, and this is maybe just me. So I have been solely using disposables now for the last 3 weeks, just buying disposables and putting my vape gear to the side, and it was just experimental for me. And one of the things that I said to myself last night, and I was at work, I go out for my lunch, I'm sitting in my car, I'm vaping, and the first thing that popped in my head was, I don't have any e-liquid on my hands. I don't have any liquid dripping from my mod. I don't have any e-liquid on my seat covers. I don't have any e-liquid on my shirt. I don't smell like, and automatically I'm thinking, what a positive this is to me, because I'm a dripper. You're a dripper too.
Yep.
And we have the occasional, I won't even say occasional. I'm like constantly overfilling, or I've forgotten. I already dripped, and I go back and drip some more, and it's gushing out the air, the air holes on my RDA. So that kind of hit me last night. I was just like, okay, I can see myself staying at this pattern just for that reason alone, is the fact that I didn't. Because I'll be honest with you, I don't know about you, but like after a week, I have to clean my car. It's everywhere. It's on my door panels. It's on my seats. It's on my shifter. It's on my steering wheel. I've got a drop of mango vape juice somewhere in my car when I'm dripping. I mean, and now you've been using them. Have you been going back and forth, or are you sticking with that disposable?
Well, all right. So, I mean, I'll give like a comparison review. So this is not to take away from the old trusty vape mods and the RTAs and the RDAs and even the coil based open systems. They've always been good to me, but I had never bought a disposable before, and I was taking that trip to Florida, and I'm like, I'll be damned if I'm gonna haul around four sets of batteries, two chargers, some big thing. I'm going to Disney. I'm not gonna keep that crap in my pocket. It's too clunky. Yeah. So then I started looking at my AIOs, and I started looking at those, and I go, well, I like those as fillers for a travel situation like that. But the reality was, is I didn't have any coils at the time. So I'm like, okay, I have an option here. I can go to the vape shop and either get some coils and roll with that and bring that around with me, or I could just walk into a vape shop and go, hey, what do you got for disposables? Let me see what you got so I can try them out, because I'd never tried them before. I can honestly tell you, after that experience down in Florida, I bought basically four different ones because I wanted to try what they had. And they were 10,000 puff ones. Kato Bar is the brand name. There are 10,000 puffs. I'm like, I don't even know what 10,000 puffs is. What does that mean? Like 10 big rippers?
Yeah.
I mean, knowing it's 50, right? So you can't really do that. But I'm like, this sounds like it would last a while. And I the flavor on these things is
dynamite.
Incredible. Absolutely incredible. The coils perform tremendously. I literally went down with four of them. I didn't even break into like the last one. Like I had one basically still closed off. I opened up one because I didn't misplace it, but I'm like, I need a buffer for the day because I don't know when these things are going to run out. I was too dumb at that moment to realize there was a little like,
They had a light indicator.
Well, yeah. I had an e-liquid level indicator on there. I didn't even realize that's what it was. Like, see that little dot?
Yeah.
So then when it gets down further, it'll go like half. And then when it starts to get low, it turns red. I did not hit the red with any of them. I was gone for almost 6 days. I came back with them all still firing, still tasting great. Coil was not burnt. Never got one dry hit out of the whole damn thing. They tasted great. I mean, I was just like, wow, what an epiphany. For the sake of having something convenient, something I can throw in my pocket, something that doesn't leak, something that is portable, you know, it's non-obtrusive. I'm like, these things were a home run. So I ended up buying four more.
So basically you come to the realization that this is you can understand now why this product is so widely accepted by so many people now.
Absolutely. And I think that the one thing that jumps out at me the most is as much time and effort as I put into cleaning my coils, re-wicking them, all that other stuff that comes with the maintenance part of using an RTA. That's not to say that the flavor didn't taste good, but usually the flavor is really only banging for like maybe like the first couple days. And then it starts to your cotton starts to get old. And it's
oversaturated.
You're losing the flavor on it. And then you're like, shit, now I got to go ahead and clean it again. And that gets a little frustrating. But now I absolutely understand why people turn to these. And I'm not saying that just for the simple reason of use of purpose, right? Fit for purpose. it's not just about all the little idiosyncrasies. I mean, it's about the fact that I've just been fully enjoying them.
Yeah, because it's gone from a product of convenience to actually a product that is substate. You can use this as your journey to beat tobacco.
Oh, and absolutely.
So I mean, that's what I got that feeling last night. And yeah, mine was due to like over dripping and all that other stuff. But I had been vaping them for a while, and I was buying them out of convenience because I was going hiking. I didn't want to take a big mod with me. I didn't want to drop it down a fucking hillside. You know, I figured, hey, if I drop this thing, you know, and it falls, you know, down the side of a mountain, you know, yes, people out there, yes, I will go find it. I'm not going to leave it out there in nature. You know, I'm going to go find it. But if I were to do that with my mod, it would be totally destroyed. It would be totally destroyed. So for me, it was that sense last night, because it was like the first time I was like, you know, and granted, you know, hey, my car smells good because it does smell like mango and all that other stuff. But when someone else gets in my car and they touch something and they get all sticky and nasty, you know, I have to explain, oh, that's e-juice. Don't worry. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's not what you think it is. It's e-juice. So, yeah. But yeah, for me, I think that's where they've gone. They've gotten to the point where we, as senior vapers that have been vaping a long time, saw it as a product of convenience. It's the last minute. We're at the store. We forgot our vape at home, or we ran out of juice while we were out running about, and it was something we can find and buy and use for the day. And a lot of times, if you think about it, Tim, the first set that came out, they were nowhere near 5,000, 8,000, 10,000 puffs. They had, you know, 250, 500 puffs, maybe tops. I remember the first ones that came out. Now, you know, like this one here, the same thing. It's got a little screen. It tells me how much battery life it has, tells me the percentage of e-liquid that's left in it. And I'm just sitting there last night, and I'm just like, I don't have any e-liquid on me. I don't have any on my pants, my shirt, my jacket, my steering wheel. I'm not dripping. I don't have this bottle that accidentally falls over in my car and spills a half of it on my seat, which happened 3 weeks ago, which made me go this route because I had a bottle in there. I thought I had turned the cap all the way tight, but I didn't. I just kind of set it on there on top of it and put it on the passenger seat. Well, I'm driving home, and all of a sudden I'm like, I got the heating seats on. So now I'm not only heating my ass, but I'm heating the e-liquid that's on the seat. I'm like, why is it such a strong smell of mango in my car right now? Yeah. And then I looked over, and it's just a puddle of e-liquid on my seat.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think if you take away some of the inconvenience about, you know, being, you know, more manual in that regard, I mean, I certainly think that this absolutely trumps that and takes all that away and simplifies it. But I mean, ultimately for me, there's zero learning curve with a disposable. Like you don't have to, unless it's just understanding what the screen is telling you in terms of information, it's simplistic enough that anybody who wants to try vaping or is looking to get off of cigarettes can grab one of these and go, and they don't have to think, they just get to vape. There's no button. There's no button. They're auto draws all the time. I mean, I'm sure there probably are a few out there that have a button or whatever. I mean, if you want to get to that level of technicality, but I mean, it just makes perfectly good sense really at this point, all you have to do is just decide what flavors you like, and you can just keep it rolling. Now, there is one downside, though.
Right? Yes, there is.
There is one downside, right? So if you read the specs on the Kato bar, I think if you look at it, it's 50, right? They didn't have any other options. I couldn't go to 36 or 24, which I probably would have preferred because I don't really need 50. But at the same time, it also tells you how much it holds. So this technically is a 25 milliliter disposable vape. So you think about a 30 mil bottle, like what you get in, you know, in your sample box, because I mean 30 mil bottles are just not a common thing much anymore nowadays. So that's your relativity. You look at that and you go, okay, well, I'm plowing through a bottle of that. But these being Nick salts and stuff like that, you know, you're not taking as big a hits off of it. So
and fewer, really.
Yeah, in the end, you know, that 25 mil goes a long way. But I mean, definitely a lifesaver. And that's not to say that I'm abandoning everything on the wall. I know.
No, I'm not either. No, I just
can't see it, but tons of fun stuff back there that I don't want to completely throw out or get rid of. I'm still intending on using it, but those effectively will just become the things I use here at the house. I'm never going to go anywhere with those. I'm just going to keep them here and use them as necessary. So,
yeah. Yeah, it's just weird. It was weird last night because I knew what I was doing. I wanted to go this route and just try this because, again, we're vapors, and do I feel like this is going to be my only option maybe in a year? And I want to prepare myself for this type of option. So, and how easy Rettle is available to me, which is shocking that I live in California and I can buy all these and walking into any friggin' store. Am I paying a little bit more than I think I should be paying? Probably. But this one, that Geek bar that I've been buying, this is a week. I'm in it a week into it. Hold on. And I'm still 74%.
So yeah, that's what I'm saying. They last an extremely long amount of time. I think I know we're getting ready to wrap up here, but I would say, I think the one thing for me that I would really love to see, I would get behind disposables as THR, because what's this all about? It's about tobacco harm reduction. It's about having something that works for everybody or specific individuals that need this. But I I'm not one of those climate weirdos. I'm not going to block traffic or anything like that. I think one thing that would really sort of maybe make people a little bit more positive towards these, if we had good recycling programs for them.
Yes.
And those don't exist right now. I know Mark's List has one, and there's some other vape shops that do it, but I would like to see more active, return programs or dispose of programs, so that we could send a message to the people who criticize us about these things and people just throwing them in the gutter and the beach and all that stuff, and say every vape shop, even manufacturers have set up collection points for you. You can take them by and you can drop them all off here. And then that, I think that would send a positive message too.
And we're all for innovation, but honest to God, we don't need a touchscreen, guys. We don't need a fucking touchscreen on the disposable vape. Do you want to show me how much battery life is in there and how much of e-liquid's left in there? Fine. Now, a little tiny screen like Tim showed you on his, that's perfectly fine. But having a full on touchscreen that has really no purpose at all, because their touchscreen, I looked at it, it doesn't do anything. Yeah. You can lock it, but all it does is lock the actual moving the power. So from medium to powerful, whatever. Right. And you can lock it, and so when you touch it, it doesn't change, but you can still hit it. So that makes absolutely no sense that you have a lock feature on a disposable that you can still hit. So I thought that was silly. So that's it. Real quick, tomorrow on In the Vapor, let me do this. We have the wonderful Skip joining me. We're going to get to know Skip tomorrow. So come join me tomorrow at 1 p.m. Like I said, this isn't a vape show. This is a way of getting to know Skip on a personal level, her likes or dislikes, her music taste. And I have a whole bunch of new questions. So, because Skip was on the show before, so we already know that Skip likes pineapple on her pizza only when she's drinking. Only when she's drinking.
But she is an icon in the world of peanut butter.
Yes.
Absolutely an icon. And we love her for it.
Actually, Tim, I have a question on there for her tomorrow, and I wanted to know what her favorite peanut butter recipe was, whether it was peanut butter cookies, peanut butter jelly sandwich, whatever her favorite way of having peanut butter is. And I have a feeling she's going to say what I'm going to say, peanut butter on a spoon.
That's it. She is an old school classic fashion peanut butter eater. You don't need bread. You don't need bananas or apples. You just grab a spoon, take the top off that sucker, and go to town. That's how you do it.
Yeah, yeah.
Hold on. What did Dave say real quick? My gripe with this.
Yeah, we talked about that too, Dave. Yeah. I think there should be a down program, just like Tim was saying earlier. There should be a way to buy this same device and make a choice whether I want 50, 35, 25, 15, 10, wherever it can go to. I don't think this would be a very suitable device any lower than 25, to be honest with me. I don't think you would get the nicotine that you need if, say, this were a 3 and a 5. I mean, yeah, what do you think? I don't think so.
I agree. I think once you get below about 18 and you start getting into those Nick strengths at that point, then you'd almost have to convert it over to like a restricted mouth to lung or something. You would need, you know, bigger hits. I know that they do Nick salts in 3 and 6 milligram, but I was using those in open systems for DTL. Yeah. So I think you would have to also have a counter product that suits that level of Nick so that you get the delivery that you're looking for.
Yeah. All right, everybody. Hey, thank you, everybody in chat, for joining us. Always glad to see you guys there and be part of the show. And the 33. Hey, you guys, I know you're watching. We've talked about this before. Say hello. Say hello. We're good people, Tim, right? We're nice people.
We're warm, huggy, fuzzy people.
And if you're the FDA watching, chime in. Say hello. Say hello.
Be our friends. Come be our friends. We don't have to be enemies, you know.
We don't have to be, no. All right, Timmy, look into the camera. Hold on, make sure I do this right.
I won't get close this time.
You won't get close this time. I look in the camera and say goodbye to everybody.
Bye, everybody. Bye, we love you guys. Thanks so much. See you next week. We'll be right back.